Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Transformation Mandate Unsquaring the Wheel webinar. I'm Sean Keough, and I'm the technical host for Konica Minolta's webinars. Once again, thank you all for joining us. This webinar is being recorded, and it will be posted on YouTube by this time next week. You will also receive a link via email. If you have any questions, we will bring a chat box during the exclusive Q&A portion of the webinar. You type in your questions in that chat box, and we will answer any questions that you might have. Thank you all once again for attending. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Transformation Mandate Unsquaring the Wheel webinar. I'm Sean Keough, and I'm the technical host for Konica Minolta's webinars. Once again, thank you all for joining us. This webinar is being recorded, and it will be posted on YouTube by this time next week. You will also receive a link via email. If you have any questions, we will bring a chat box during the exclusive Q&A portion of the webinar. You type in your questions in that chat box, and we will answer any questions that you might have. Thank you all once again for attending. So without further ado, I'm going to kick it off to Konica Minolta's ProCom Marketing Manager, Dawn Nye. Dawn, how are you today?
I'm doing great. Thanks, Sean. We have an exciting deck for all of you. This is our first time doing this webinar and educational series. You'll hear more about it at the end of the presentation. So I'm not going to take any of the thunder. I'm going to quickly pass it off to our professor, Chris Bondy, which I've known for many years, which has great information to be able to start your transformation. Chris, take it away.
Great, Don. Thank you, and good afternoon. So today we're going to explore the why, the what, and the how associated with change in the graphic communications industry. I think many of us can relate that we're really in a perfect storm. We've got this rare combination of circumstances that are really an intense situation, and I think our perfect storm is really the management of technology, cultural changes, and also the economic conditions that we deal with. We'll explore this, and in terms of the transformation mandate, that's really the why and the what. Why change, and what are we going to change into? Unsquaring the wheel is the mechanism to tell us how. As we explore this together, we'll see that unsquaring the wheel helps us understand these conditions and help align our individual businesses to best accommodate the transformation that's necessary. So, first of all, looking at technology, I think we can all relate as consumers and knowledge workers that technology is impacting us tremendously. First, it was fast chips, and if many of us know Moore's Law, every 18 months technology doubles and price remains constant. We can go to a Best Buy every couple years and buy a computer for about the same price with about twice the performance. But even eclipsing fast processors is the notion of really free or very inexpensive mass storage. Storage has eclipsed the performance of chip technology, and now we can pretty much store anything in the cloud or even on our phones or our laptops or tablets. Storage is really quite inexpensive. The third component of the technology triple play is that we can basically have unlimited bandwidth and be completely untethered from technology. So we're wireless, and that wireless broadband allows us to have many different options in our communication and in the way that we sort of culturally perform as consumers and as knowledge workers in enterprise. So all of these components are compiling together to really bring in this notion of this mass global digitization. Everything that we see, everything we hear, is fully digitized. In many cases, it's digitized before it's in an analog form. And these are all trends that we know, but they're definitely impacting the graphic communications industry in a positive way and sometimes in a negative way. Smart mobile technology pretty much has been our fulcrum point for all types of communications. And we have to consider that now when we're looking at all of our new workflows. Here's an example of how mobile technology has really changed in the last 5 to 10 years. If we look at this image in 2005, Pope Benedict's inauguration, We can see a lonely little clamshell in the lower right corner trying to capture the vise, and this was probably a mover and shaker at that time, a lead adopter. Let's fast forward to Pope Francis in 2013. There's a sea of mobile devices capturing the vent. And again, we can look at the glass half full or half empty. From a half full perspective, all of this digital imaging has to have a home, has to have a place, a workflow, and in many cases, there's still many print-related opportunities here. We just have to know how to move upstream and capture the images and the cultural technology changes that are taking place. We can see that managing collections is really an important component of technology nowadays. YouTube, where this video, in fact, will be posted, iTunes, has really become the digital asset management system for consumers, knowledge workers, and enterprises alike. And that trend continues to move forward. This is a photo I shot right out of my windshield in Rochester, New York, with Blockbuster Video, which incidentally now is a pet supply store. This has been eclipsed now by Netflix, because many of us can use Netflix to watch syndicated shows when we want them without the advertising and on our schedule and such. So if we look at the consumer and knowledge worker trends around media consumption, by the year 2020, 80% of all media is digital. This plays directly into the hand to the complement of digital printing to traditional printing. Traditional for the long run, cost-effective reasons, and digital for short run personalization. Looking at 2020, we can see that digital TV completely replaces analog TV, and the internet continues to be a primary sort of form of media communications. The important point here is, if you were an individual in the 1900s versus an individual in 2020, look at the full range of media channels that we have available to us. So the complexity for service providers nowadays is to understand how judicially to manage this marketing mix and make sure that print is in the play, but it's also leveraging the other media complementary so that we can get to all media at all times for various campaigns. We can see print in the bottom in the orange band. It's still there, it's still viable, and it's a very important component of the marketing mix, but unlike the 1900s, it's not the only game in town. We really just need to find and understand how print fits. Same thing may be true with social media. Social media, came out as a little bit of a fad and a consumer interest, and now companies are realizing that they can create unique groups and communities that actually create better customer alignment and a customer experience and a more intimate relation with their customers. So we're finding that social media now has a play in the business sector, not just for consumers. I think we would all agree, especially for those of us who are heavily involved in digital print, that understanding and knowing our data from a 360-degree view is critical. You know, and we build this data pyramid saying that, you know, we all have data abounding, and the more things that are digital, the more data there is. Once we can organize our data, now we have information. And when we can use that information in an intelligent way to build strategies and campaigns, it turns into knowledge. So no longer is transactional data enough. The name, address, email, IP address, mobile numbers, that's fine to tell where people are at. But we need to go a step further and understand behavioral information. We need the demographics, psychographics, buying habits, and preferences of individuals so that we can definitely contact them and participate with them in a life cycle marketing manner, such that they get the right information they need at the time and place they are in their life cycle as a customer. Other trends that we're dealing with is the economic trends. We know that in 2008, we have one of the most severe recessions in the history of the United States. In fact, it was the first time since the Great Depression that gross domestic product had dropped for all developed nations, including U.S., Japan, Western Europe. And we all had to respond to that and understand what the demand is for print. Marketers had to reconcile marketing budgets. They had senior management looking at them closer to understand, you know, how do we measure the effectiveness of your marketing budget? But you can see in recent months, the market starts to turn again, and it starts to move, and we start to understand other intercepts for print and how print fits within a cross-media or omni-channel environment. But sure enough, we'll have other economic recessions at times, and there will be periods of misalignment. My point is that if we stay up on our technology and cultural and economic components of our business, then we'll be agile and fleet-footed and understand how to adapt to the changes as we're confronted with these market-changing conditions. So it's kind of like a domino effect. We've got technology change that impacts the way we work. We've got cultural change that impacts, you know, how we use technology and communicate, both, again, as consumers and knowledge workers. There's economic change that impacts what we buy and the types of companies we serve and the budgets they have available. And consumer and knowledge workers all react to these conditions. And then it's our job as service providers to comprehend these waves of domino effects and to move back upstream in the market, understand these changes, and readjusting and refining our services so that we meet the needs of knowledge workers and enterprises and consumers if we're in a B2C space, and using the latest technology to really, I'll say, transform and meet that market more effectively. So in kind of a visual diagram, understand that these incremental steps was probably an example of the time prior to 2008. We're moving along with incremental growth every year, maybe 5% growth, 8% growth, and so forth. 2008 hits and the recession blows up the market, and we've got misalignment. There's gaps. We have all kinds of issues. And this is the fork in the road that we're all dealing with, is what do we do to transform? Do we take a steady state road and hang on to the business we have and continually downsize, or find roads for better efficiency so that we can reduce costs and become more cost-effective in our operation? Or do we read all these business signs and transform our business to be more aligned with where the market moved to? I think that the most successful companies are the ones that really hang on to their steady state business, but simultaneously develop a strategy to move to the new space where companies are going in terms of their communication needs. The key point here is that we all have the same components. We have a customer, we have our own resources and our processes around those resources. This would be our production facility. And we have to adjust those key resources and processes to meet the value proposition of the customer while simultaneously finding the right profit formula that works for us. This is really a difficult assignment with all these moving parts. And it's definitely difficult if we don't have a strategic plan. So the truth is, a revolution is needed. We need to really think in advanced ways and make careful strategic moves to move ourselves into a new space that's aligned with the market. If I go back to history, I'll use an example here of how profound a revolution can be. Up until about the mid-1500s, most of the world felt that the world was flat, and if we ran our ship to the edge of the earth, we would just fall off. And there was a lot of mystery, mysticism about that, the world and how large it was and so forth. Then comes along Copernicus, and he developed this heliocentric model, which says that the Earth was really round, and it rotated around the Earth. And you can imagine back in the 1500s, this was a pretty revolutionary concept. Most people at the time thought he was crazy, And in fact, it was 100 years that passed before the world realized that Copernicus's model was actually valid. And it took the invention of the microscope and Galileo to actually prove that the Copernicus heliocentric model was accurate. The interesting thing is, even after 100 years of Copernicus's observations and his paper, Galileo spent the last years of his life, 100 years later, under house arrest for his radical ideas about the world being round. And I think if we think of revolutions, we're kind of in that similar mode today, where all these different media types need to coexist, and we've got marketers out there that don't quite understand and know the most appropriate mix to tackle their communications problems. So these revolutions are transformative upheavals that occur, and it's really, we need them in order to survive. I pretty much state, as well as I think ID Alliance, that we're really in the third great economic revolution. We would call this the information revolution or the digital revolution. And we're living in it right now. So again, give yourself some credit for the past, you know, 5 to 10 years and all of the activity that has happened and coming at us, how we've been able to navigate. But these revolutions are very similar to the Industrial Revolution or the Agricultural Revolution. Here's the difference, is that it's moving faster than either, and no one's exempt. So it used to be lifespan of a Fortune 500 company was 67 years, and today it's 15 years. And so we can see that with the pace of technology adoption, the pace of the markets, the digital revolution is really ripping the cover off the ball in terms of cycle time and how quickly we need to move to be aligned with the market. So what business are we in? Well, for the first time, we can see that non-litho-related services in our industry is beginning to eclipse the traditional print side of the market. So in 2017, we're projecting that 52% of the revenues across our industry eclipse litho, and for the first point, we're at that tipping point where these services are you know, larger and more impactful. Of course, the both one without the other doesn't really work very well. And of course, this information is provided from ID Alliance. Another chart from ID Alliance shows that in 2014, the commercial litho revenue was $35.8 billion versus $59.3 billion, quite a huge percentage decline. And digital print has, although it has a huge percentage increase, it doesn't quite fill the gap of the part of the market that we lost in long-run traditional print. And so that additional market opportunity or revenue has to be made up by moving upstream and downstream in our workflow to add other services that round out what marketers need and also provide us a more cohesive value proposition from concept to full delivery. Our industry is really a transformative industry. If you think about it, we're bringing in all of our historic knowledge about imaging, high-speed digital printing, content management, variable data printing, proofing, and so forth, and we're combining that with information technology. A great complement we have here in our university is graphic communications and computer science tied together. It's exactly my background, and it seems like the more we know about information technology, the more we can leverage our strength and positioning in the graphic communications industry and business. So we're all on this transformation. Some people are entering at different places, but the continuum, if I go through the whole history, begins really with static, long-run printing, and the first value proposition of digital print, which is just print on demand. No inventory, print what you want when you need it. And then we move kind of the next step up to say, well, not only could I print on demand, but I could personalize. And if I want further automation, I could have some web job submission approach that automates the workflow such that a web interface actually triggers the release of the job into production. So as we move along this continuum, we find that commercial printing companies start shifting their spend ratio in terms of their investment in their capital equipment and employees almost one-to-one with the traditional print and finishing side of the business into digital print workflow, sales, marketing, and strategy. Companies that have fully evolved are spending a 2-to-1 ratio on the front-end side of the business, and they have positioned themselves much further upstream, integrating their whole MIS system, selling from a project management perspective, offering more comprehensive digital services, asset management, database services, and tying together the ability to not only produce, but to measure, to run campaigns, measure campaigns, and deliver the statistical results of how the campaigns are performing. This value proposition in the final advanced transformative stage is really what marketers are looking for. They're looking for service providers that can really handle the entire value stream from concept to delivery across all media. So where do we start? We're saying a lot. There's a lot of dynamics going on in the marketplace. Where do we begin? Well, Peter Drucker was a longstanding management advisor, and you know his advice, I think, still rings true. We have to begin by looking internally and looking at our customers and asking the right questions. So asking questions like, you know, what are we doing better today than we did 6 months ago? What are we doing worse than we did 6 months ago? You know, how are we becoming more valuable to our clients? Asking our clients what they want and don't want. You know, what are the internal barriers that are holding us back from advancing, and what are the points of leverage that are, you know, maybe at the strength that we can, you know, offer as a core competency? This is how we came to the notion of this business transformation assessment. We started thinking, with so many companies in turmoil around the globe related to this transformation in the printing industry, the companies need to get a baseline of where they're at. They need to try to understand, and they, you know, where they stand regarding this transformation. And each company's different, and the perception of each business owner might be different than some of their senior management. The finance person might have one view, the marketing sales team might have another view, the production and operational people might have a different view. All of those views need to come together with one clear direction for how and what we should do related to transformation. What's the priority, and what should we work on with our scarce resources? So the business transformation assessment, or we call it just the BTA, is a way that you can get that baseline reference. It is really your current reality. By going through the survey, you're able to get a view of how you feel about your business by 9 unique vantage points. And this allows you to set realistic goals, and you can find that over time you might do the assessment several times to just see how, you know, you've improved and if those sort of prevailing weak areas continue to be an issue. So this Unsquaring the Wheel business transformation assessment looks at 9 critical vectors, and the way we've designed this with Dr. Joe Webb and Wayne Peterson, myself, is we look at 3 key platforms: the customer discipline, the platform discipline, and the resources discipline. And each of those have 3 discrete areas that we look further in. So inside of the customer scenario, we're looking at brand, business development, and customer experience. Inside a platform, we're looking at what is the technology, process, and services that are underpinning your operation. And resources, we look at people, finance, and alliances. And again, when we're able to view all of these areas in one simultaneous snapshot of the business, it can tell us quite a bit. So the way the BTA works is you'll log in through the information that Don and I will provide you, and you're going to answer a series of questions. The way the interface is presented, it will present a particular discipline, and it'll provide you a statement. For example, does your brand clearly portray your offering to customers? And what you're going to do is you're going to pick one of the six statements below that best reflects your current reality. And as you move through the questionnaire, you will be asked several questions, and finding the statement that matches, just continuing with that 15 to 20 minute process, what will come on the output of that will be a radar chart. And the radar chart will show you where your current reality is based on a benchmark. And the way we determined a benchmark is that I conducted a study of over 300 printing companies across the United States and had a very simple metric for success. The metric was, if you're growing your business 2 times industry standard revenue while simultaneously delivering 2 times industry standard profit to the bottom line, we wanted to talk to you. Interesting enough, out of those 320 sites we looked at, only 6%, 19 companies met that standard. After meeting with each of those companies, interviewing them, and walking through their workflow, we were able to determine some of the key transformative factors associated with companies that have really broken through in our industry, what they're doing around that. So we built a maturity model that is this desired state transformation transform company. And while you're answering the questions, we have an inference engine that's basically taking those answers and looking at it against the model and then portraying back to you where you stand. So in this particular example, we can see that the wheel certainly isn't round. And we can see that the areas that really need some important attention would be people, process, finance, business development, brand, and maybe customer experience. The strong areas, the points of leverage, are alliances, technology, and services. So those areas are probably an area of strength that you could leverage. Incidentally, when we meet at Print 2017, and we'll be talking about a workshop that Konica Minolta is offering that I will lead, we will actually take your business transformation assessment with a SWOT analysis, and you'll work at tables to try to uncover your strengths and weaknesses in the beginning of your action plan for your firm. So this is very practical work that can help you gain alignment within your firm. As part of the business transformation assessment report, you'll also get a maturity rating in a written form. It'll tell you what the particular discipline is. It will tell you the maturity rating. In this case, the maturity rating is it's good for, known for good things. And these are the characteristics of this rating. The initial brand strategy is created and is communicated internally. There's admirable traits built into positioning, widespread market awareness, the value proposition, and comparison with a direct competitor beginning to become more difficult. So this is kind of a snapshot of where this particular firm is as it relates to brand. Each one of the 9 different vectors would have detail at this level. It doesn't tell you the plan of what to do to, let's say, transform, but it tells you the status of where you are in that continuum. So why is this an important starting point? Well, the BTA offers you the ability to discover your current reality, helps you identify the gaps and misalignments, and enables you to determine what needs to be transformed, and helps you maybe with a little bit better pinpointing of your annual goals. The value of this unstructured analysis, or the structured analysis, is that it's a process that provides you a holistic view of 9 different vantage points simultaneously. You can also take this across your leadership team. So maybe someone in customer service or production will also take this and allows you to have a great talking basis for where there's misalignment within the plant. I've conducted private workshops with different firms, and some of the leadership team in these firms have all taken the BTA prior to my visit, and then we use this as a talking point to do an annual plan together, and it helps the companies, again, be a little bit more aligned and focused. Working with these 9 unique vectors at a simultaneous snapshot can provide you a view that you probably don't get. Many times people are very surprised when they look at their wheel. They answer the questions truthfully. They're honest about what their status is really on each of the questions. And at the end, when they look at the wheel, it's kind of an interesting surprise to say, wow, we really have a neat growth in this area, or we're really strong in this area. Again, it pinpoints the importance of the changes we need to make in each firm. And the complement to this is the Unscoring the Wheel book, which is like a field guide that gives you a little bit more detail than just an hour-long webinar on how you might transform, but gives sort of the inside backstory on each of these different components as it relates to change. Sometimes the best way to understand this, and I know in a virtual sense, all this information coming to you quite quickly, is to look at a case study. So let's take a look at Direct Marketing Express out of Fort Lauderdale. Mike Panaggio is the owner there, also a good friend, and he went through this process with me. If we look at DME, they're in Fort Lauderdale, a pretty large operation, over 500 employees, revenues over $100 million. And they offer, they're pretty evolved. They offer more than just print. They really focus on cross-media direct marketing campaigns. They've also got several different product lines that they've developed from their company. As they go into vertical markets, they maybe have a successful market engagement plan that's worked well, and then they'll productize that in that vertical market and expand it to other geographies like the DME automotive and some of these other products. You can, I'm sure, dig more by finding their site. But here's a look at Mike's wheel. So even, you know, I'll tell you in advance that DME is a transformed company. They operate at, twice the average revenue growth and simultaneous 2x profit. And yet when he looks at his wheel, he could see that he still needed more development in the area of process, customer experience, and alliances for sure. So some of the aspects of his transformation was to put more time in a consultative selling approach, you know, understanding how do they really present at the high level in an organization, and how do they become relevant in the boardroom and be able to present and extract value for their value-added services is a critical need he saw and that we see systemically across our industry. They make a heavy investment in IT and software development. They have a full software development department. They've got developers on board, and they have the ability to write software, develop websites, and do what they need in-house, which really is a strong point of leverage. They're constantly investing in a web-based customer experience, since we know in time, if the customer experience is robust on the web, it can reduce costs and also streamline the processes in many ways. But it's not an out-of-the-box solution. Constantly working on taking waste out of his production operation, automating his workflow. DME has pretty much moved from this hybrid workflow of litho and digital print, where they were basically doing litho shells and personalization through black and white sheet fed digital, and now pretty much moved all the litho out of the operation, and they're now just basically color digital. They became, you know, they chose X and Pi as a solution for them. There's many different VDP engines out there. It doesn't have to be X and Pi. It could be several other solutions. The point is they focused on one, and they got skills associated with that. Talk about moving upstream and downstream. Not only were they proficient at delivering direct mail, but they also opened a call center so that on the back end of their campaigns, they actually can provide the service of the follow-up calls related to the direct mail, and they're able to quantify the success of various campaigns and marketing tests back upstream to their client, such that the client can make adjustments and changes in the types of campaigns they do based on the actual results of the direct mail. They constantly are looking for talent, new hires, and they're trying to maintain a culture where, you know, people want to work at their firm. It's a difficult daily challenge because, you know, good people are on the move. So their transformative business model is really creative design delivered through selective communications channels. So they really want to be upstream in the workflow where the job originates, where the creativity begins, and help strategize with the customer, and from that, help build the entire cross-media delivery. But being upstream is critical to their success. Deliver the sort of concept to fulfillment solution, not just marks on paper and not just a bid and buy scenario. He's also established a culture across his plant where it's okay to fail, you know, where employees can take risk and fail and not sweep the failure under the rug, but bring the failure front and center directly to him. Tell him what you did and what failed and why. Mike leverages that as a great learning opportunity, and he creates sort of the entrepreneurship spirit across his plant where people can take risks, but there's accountability for those risks, and if there is a failure, everyone benefits from it in a learning experience. And he also feels that the young talent coming into his operation can't wait. They're not going to necessarily be tied to a production activity forever. They have to find a way that they can move up with the business and move out into different functions. So he creates an environment where the top talent can move. In fact, many of those businesses you saw on the first slide were really people in his company who took a lead role and have now moved on to being kind of the entrepreneurial owner of that new business as he expands it. So he still has issues. He's constantly working integration issues, and it's an issue we deal with in our industry, that there's still many, many points of integration that need to take place. Constantly working on the culture. What are some of the results? Well, even through the tough times years ago in the market, he was continuing to grow on this 2x plus rate. He's also been able to measure and expand in his sales effort by putting more attention in that upstream sale and strategic sale. Well, he's kind of have a split sales force with people serving the existing customers and business development people really working new vertical markets and further upstream opportunities. Constantly working on talent recruitment. For the future, he wants to move into other markets that, of course, look like the markets he's in right now, because adjacencies are typically the best way to expand. Continue leading with selling and vertical market penetration. It's a great tip for all of us. The more we're active in vertical markets and the more we're moving upstream in a strategic sale, the more value we'll be able to extract. He's also looking for other operations that might be geographically in the right place to partner with, and maybe even have an equity play in these companies as they join his network. So as we kind of come down the home stretch on today's webinar, the reality of a revolution, that their economic revolutions create historic opportunity for the prepared and profound threats for the unprepared, no matter how big, established, or successful you've been. And so our job is really to get ourselves prepared by understanding these trends, consumer trends, knowledge worker trends, enterprise trends, the interplay of technology, of the economic and cultural changes, and understand how we can gain our competitive advantage by using print as a fulcrum point, but moving upstream into more of the data, marketing, creative services, and downstream into fulfillment and logistics, so that the marketer can have confidence that they can come to us with one truly integrated workflow. I think many might look at the glass half empty because our industry in many ways is converging. The transactional, promotional, publishing, packaging, label, and even printed products, aspects of our industry are all colliding. We see commercial printers playing in every one of these sectors to some degree. And years ago, they were all very separate industries. But if we look at the glass half full, every time one of our industry segments collides with another, there's another opportunity for growth. So at each overlap where transactional meets promotional, we have a whole new industry or a whole new segment of transpromo. Individuals doing marketing communications tied with transactional, getting the free ride on postage, and being able to, deliver relevant messages and offers. And you can see across this chart other areas where there's opportunities where individuals are entering into the marketplace solely for the opportunities that have now collided thanks to technology. So even Idea Alliance for Graph Expo last year identified many different opportunities for growth. There's 20 more or more new products in direct mail, display, point of purchase, wide format, and digital print. Different process capabilities. We're getting more streamlined in our variable data workflows and being able to manage color holistically across any device and any media. And new services, really thinking through a cross-media marketing strategy tied with our print can be a home run for many companies that have endeavored down that path. So I would offer that our new workflow looks a little more like this. It really begins with strategy, and strategy is formulated by us meeting with our clients and understanding what their starting point is. What are their business objectives? How do they get measured? What are some key performance indicators that are important to them? And we can only get that understanding through looking at their data and their content and their existing campaigns and coming up with a strategy that allows us to take their assets, build new assets, creative, and bring it together in an integrated workflow, and controlling that workflow in a simultaneous delivery of print, mobile, web, and social media. Incidentally, in the School of Media Sciences, which was the School of Print Media, and now, over a 70-year-old school, RIT was known as the Harvard of Print. We've modified our curriculum to be focused on print, but we also have added all of the cross-media capabilities such that students coming through our program understand print in its traditional sense, color management, print process workflow, but then they build on that digital print, and then they build further database publishing, variable print, web development and deployment, production management, and project management. And we think that that's the new profile of our industry, and it's also the new profile of employees that we think the industry will be looking for. So this will come all together for us at Print this year. We've got an event planned, a lunch and learn, on September 12th, 2017, and the room is listed there above. And this will be a 12:30 to 2 session, and it'll be a workshop to basically come with your BTAs. Have done your BTA ahead of time, come, and we'll work to try to organize you at tables with kind of similar shaped wheels, and we'll go through a very simple interactive SWOT analysis to help you take that wheel a step further towards an action plan. So we urge you to take advantage of, if you haven't yet, doing the business transformation assessment. Thanks to Conica Minolta for Procom customers, it's free. Otherwise, it's a $50 cost to do the assessment. And for those of you who will have the opportunity to come to Chicago and to print 2017, I look forward to meeting you firsthand. In terms of my background, I'm a commercial print owner. I've been a chief technology officer in one of the largest direct mail companies across the country. And I came to academia after 30 years in the industry as a print service provider. My ambition in life right now is to help the next generation of, young adults get excited about our industry and position them so that they can go out to your firms in the workforce. The second part of my passion is to help print service providers, folks like you, learn how to transform and learn how to sort of take the great success you've had in the historic and traditional printing industry and parlay that forward to a cross-media communications service provider that really is aimed and targeted at the movement and direction of the marketplace. So I thank you very much for your time today, and it looks like we're right on schedule for some question and answers if you have any.
Hey, Chris, thank you so much for that presentation. For all the participants on the live webinar, I will be pulling up the chat box in just a moment. For the participants on the recorded version, however, we will not be including that. Thank you all once again.